for the afternoon. So please attend, everyone. And I want to make sure that I introduce our first speaker for this afternoon, which is Dr. Igor Akusevich. And he's a research professor with the Biodemography of Aging Research Unit and Social Science Research Institute.
Okay, thank you for coming. I will tell you on analytic methods for health disparities in Alzheimer's disease and related dementia. So we know that the burden associated with Alzheimer's disease is not equally distributed among geographical areas in the United States and among subpopulation. Therefore, an important aspect of this problem, actually problem, because disparity goes up for majority of situation. So, and we need to deal with this disparity by evaluation them and then explanation in terms of predictors. In this report, we will discuss analytics methods capable of explaining persistent sex ratio and geographic disparities and Alzheimer's disease and related dementia in terms of predictors. We will use 5% Medicare data for majority of our analysis.
Right now works.
Yes, now works. Thank you. So we need to start with evaluation of these disparities. Here you see estimates of prevalence proportion, incidence-based mortality, and incidence rate. All cases estimates for black are higher than for white. So now, empiric patterns of Alzheimer's disease survival. It's quite difficult to say which is higher. That's, let's go to hazard ratio estimated using Cox model. And we will see this table for Alzheimer's disease and for Alzheimer's disease and dementia, incidence and survival. And we see that estimates for black, all estimates versus white. So estimates for black are higher than one. This is for incident, but estimates for survival is lower than one. So survival is better for this population versus individuals with individuals with white population. So let's go to geographic disparities. We see geographic disparities of incidence rate calculated using Medicare data, and we see a higher rate in the area of so-called stroke belt states. This is here. So we can check subpopulations, and we see that effect can't be explained by demographic structure, because in all subpopulations, the rates are higher. Below, you can see another example. This is already hazard ratio, not rates. And again, in majority cases, we see that higher incidence in Alzheimer's disease and related dementia are consistent with better survival in respective disadvantaged populations. So we just talked about how to estimate these disparities. Now, we would like to discuss how to explain these estimated disparities in terms of predictors. So, there are standard methods typically used just to compare hazard ratio calculated using Cox model. And also, there are new advanced approaches that I will discuss. Now, so standard approaches. A predictor explains some portion of health disparity if effect associated with respective disparity affected group, like race, is significantly reduced when we add this predictor to the list of predictors in our Cox model. This is an approach broadly used for explanation of health disparities. However, there are limitations in this approach. First of all, no rigorous mathematical formalism underlying this approach. Second, effect can be not additive and depends on the order how we add predictors to the model. And also we have to understand that when we compare hazard ratio of different Cox model estimates, we have to remember that we have different baseline hazard, not estimated this. And it means that comparison of hazard ratio does not mean that we compare actual rates of Alzheimer's disease. We used this example, applied this approach for 5% Medicare, and you can see what we have. We considered first dual eligibility variables to demonstrate social economic status of individuals, and then added disease indicators. And we found this estimate. You can see this is estimate it used due to social economic status, and then adding diseases, we have effectively reduced hazard ratio. We don't interpret this as an actual explanation of disparity, but this provides us with more or less a reasonable preliminary understanding about size of the effect expected predictors. So let's go to what I mean by advanced analytic approach. First one, polar decomposition of life expectancy difference. We would like to understand which diseases are responsible for difference in life expectancy at 65 between two compared population. And originally, this approach was developed by Pollard, and this you can see his formula in terms of integral with hazard ratio, disease-specific hazard ratios, life expectancy, and survival functions of compared populations, for example, living by subpopulation. It's actually too general. And we need to specify this somehow to deal with our specific data sets. So let's try. This is our specification. We developed an approach assuming a Kaplan-Meier estimator for Medicare data and a live table approach for multiple cause of death data. And we were able to write this component of polar decomposition, disease-specific component in terms of actually extractable variables from these data sets. So we can discuss in detail who is in this, how we have embedded it, what does it. So let's understand what we are speaking about, which disparities we would like to explain in this case. This is disparity in life expectancy at age 65. So we have leading state in this case was the same life expectancy, lagging state, led by subpopulation, multiple cause of death data, and Medicare data. Very similar picture, very similar trends. And we have difference or disparities between states, this is geographic disparity, it goes up, and there is disparity also. And the same situation in Medicare data. Let's try to explain this existence of these disparities in terms of very specific disease, thank you, disease-specific contributions. So it looks like this. If we have a difference between life expectancy at 65 is 100%, we have contribution from disease, from causes of death. Specific part. And we can see that Alzheimer's is the second among all diseases contributing to this disease. And its contribution to this actually program, goes up this time. So, second approach, partitioning analysis. Partitioning analysis is designed quantify contributions of changes or disparities in incidence, relative survival. Contribution of change in prevalence and incidence-based mortality in terms of changes or respective disparities in incidence, survival, or other measures like initial prevalence, for example, prevalence of 65, eligibility to Medicare. So why it's important? Look, for example, if we have prevalence going up, we don't know if it's good or bad because it could be because of increased incidence with time, increasing incidence, or improving survival. Yeah, increasing incidence, not good, improving survival. So, and the partitioning analysis is designed to decompose these trends or disparities in terms of this specific point. In this example, you can see decomposition of disparity in racial disparity in Alzheimer's disease. And we see that the main contribution comes from this total disparity. Disparities defined by incidence. So next, accepted decomposition generalized for time to event data. This analysis is designed to explain difference between rates like this in terms of two effects per each predictor. One of the effects, so-called exposure effects, characterizes the effect of difference in prevalence of risk factor, and another one, vulnerability, characterizes the effect in the magnitude of the effect of the risk factor between two groups. So it is clear why, for example, if disease contributes to disparity, it can be because of different prevalence of disease, and maybe different effect of individuals with disease on our Alzheimer's disease outcome, something like this. So, make this analysis to explain black-white disparities in Alzheimer's disease and related dementia risk in terms of prevalence of risk related. We considered three indicators, they can be considered 10 diseases. Then found that hypertension is a common contributor and considered also so called morbidity profiles of individuals. Have hypertension, not have diabetes, have health disease, something like this. And applied the decomposition for 32 morbidity profile indicators, so all possible combinations that is mutually excluded combinations, or selected DD. And our conclusion again that leading contributor to difference in Alzheimer's disease risk and related dementia risks between black and white subpopulation is due to hypertension. 20% of this effect is due to exposure effect, and 80% of this effect is due to vulnerability effect. And all other diseases are far behind hypertension. In this plot, you can see age-specific rates. It's interesting then when we address, when we calculate unexplained part of the effect, we will see that this logarithm of this plot, we will see that black had a higher rate before applying zinc analysis, but unexplained part is lower than before. It means the disease explains a huge portion of this disparity, especially for black population. So I would recommend, I would suggest to use a so-called hierarchical framework for analysis of health disparities with three basic states, steps. Step number one, association between Alzheimer's disease is estimated using this Aksaka-Blinder based model, resulting in two effects we just discussed, exposure effect and vulnerability effect. Second, total, we received this decomposition, right? Like here, yeah, we have some exposure effect of original disparity, and we have vulnerability. Most huge vulnerability can be analyzed again of the same approach for cohorts with individuals with this predictor. For example, if it's hypertension, we need to consider individuals with hypertension and apply the same approach. Also, we can use so-called rank and replace approach. We will discuss this. The most large exposure effect, it means difference in prevalence, can be analyzed again using partitioning approach. It will produce the difference in incidence risk or survival, and again, Aksaka-Blinder can be applied to further decompose next disease, like hypertension, for example. So this is the example of rank and replace approach. This is idea of this approach is to create some subpopulation using rank of predictors, actually linear predictor of constructed from different predictors, and then to replace these predictors from one subpopulation to another subpopulation in order to have some pseudo populations that are different only by these variables. So, and then we estimate effect of our predictor in this case, so economic status, comparing these pseudo populations. And we believe that estimation in our case, this is 35% higher risk of Alzheimer's disease and black. And we believe that this is almost causally responsible. Because look, this is approach is similar to what we remember from propensity score-based approach. Idea of many causal methods is to create, to model situation of clinical trial. And we need to have populations, pseudo populations, population with weights in such a way that are equivalent in all variables except of variable of interest. And this is one of the approach that produce this situation and give us the time of estimate that partly can be interpreted as causal estimates. So, second, exposure effect. If for certain situation, exposure effect is large, 20% of difference in Alzheimer's disease we found, this is due to difference in prevalence of hypertension between black and white. Let's apply our partitioning model in order to explain difference between black and white in the population. So we applied, and we will see this picture again. This is the total disparities of hypertension, and we see that majority of the effect came from prevalence at 65. It means that individuals entered to Medicare data with this disability. Already with this disability, then determine disability in Alzheimer's disease. It means we have to go to age below 65, normalize why we have this disability. One opportunity to use market scan data, for example, with records and millions of individuals, and opportunity to understand why we have disability in 65, and this this is important for our future observation on Alzheimer's disease. So now let's consider methods for population attributable fractions. Recently, this group suggested that addressing 40% of dementia cases, we need to work with a group of modifiable risk factors. And they did it based on analysis of population attributable fraction for each predictor. It means that population attributable fraction means proportional reduction in population disease incidence or mortality that would occur if exposure to this risk factor was zero. So how to make this analysis? A typical approach for this to consider individual measurements. We need, what we need to calculate individual proportional individual paths, is the real decrease of this predictor to Alzheimer's disease and prevalence. How to find respective information? Prevalence for each risk factor and the relative risk for Alzheimer's are taken from independent studies. Then we know that these predictors are correlated, not independent. Therefore, people use additional study with all measurements, maybe without even Alzheimer's, but with all predictors in order to estimate mutual correlation between them. And then they need a statistical methodology to combine somehow this information and calculate decomposition of total risk in terms of decomposition of these paths. There are, the question is, what is statistical methodology that will be used? There are three formulas, and the most popular is the Norton formula that involves the notion of commonality. Commonality is the proportion of variance shared with other risk factor evaluated using methods of factor or principal component analysis. So this is very, very popular approach. More than 2,000 or 3,000 references to this paper for this methodology. However, we didn't find a rigorous mathematical background for this formula. And instead, we developed our own approach, how to develop and apply this statistical methodology in order to address this research question. And we found exact formula without simplified adaption to describe the covariance structure or simplify the retained formula. This approach requires a notion of quasi-covariances, covariances of many independent variables. But in this way, we were able to develop the theory and apply to Medicare data. That's our illustration what we received for Alzheimer's disease and the contribution of a specific disease. Important property of this theory is that it's naturally generalizable for this case. In this case, we need to
use measures, respect measures, the proportional reduction in observed display that was argued and excluded in factor related to zero. So in usually here we explain risk. Now we explain difference between in risk between two subpopulations. It's naturally incorporated. So let me go to causal methods.
This causal mediation analysis provides the causal estimate of so-called direct and indirect effects of predictor on outcome. We specifically tested the hypothesis that air pollution predictor PM2.5 contributes to the risk of Alzheimer's disease both directly via its impact on neurodegeneration, for example, and indirectly through associated with higher risk of Alzheimer's disease and related dementia pre-existing diseases. So it means that air pollution can contribute to the risk directly, maybe on the individual processes neurodegeneration, or indirectly to increase the risk of diseases that are risk factors of Alzheimer's disease. We applied this approach. This again, we used this formula. And there are some limitations of this formula, but generally works because Alzheimer's disease is a relatively rare event. And we found each specific indirect effects. In percent, we see that it can reach 10% again, arterial hypertension is on the top. Come on, we see effect of stroke and depression as a direct effect of air pollution. And my final approach is parametric G-formula causal decomposition. It's again a method designed for longitudinal causal estimates, maybe with time-dependent treatment or time-dependent, for example, changing exposure with time. So usually four steps are used in order to again create pseudo populations that are similar in all variables except of variables of interest, our treatment for exposure and disparities. So these are steps, and again maybe we need to in way of Monte Carlo, we estimated regression, use the regression to create subpopulation, and then make our estimation using this subpopulation. And then we can compare estimates from created subpopulation and original natural subpopulation we have in data. Maybe we need to repeat many times this approach in order to address some variability. So we applied for classified disparity approach and found some difference. And the difference can be interpreted as a causal effect. And let me go to my conclusion. So I would say that we measured disparity, and we see that geographic and sales disparities in Alzheimer's disease and related dementia are significant and persistent in general US population of older adults. Main methods of measuring such disparities include comparison of age-adjusted rates between subpopulations and hazard ratio obtained from both models. Approaches for explaining disparities in terms of predictors based on comparison of hazard ratio from different Cox model have limitations and cannot be interpreted causally. I recommend to further develop, use, and apply to data this analytical approach we just discussed. And finally, I will say that Medicare data, this is a data set with traditional statistical power and huge potential for starting with clinical and cognitive and related dementia and three interacting direction, multi-ethnic and structural population, place of residence, and time period. That is, can be considered as defined as one. Thank you.
Thank you very much. There is a question in the Q&A section. So to clarify, one needs longitudinal data, and if so, how many waves of data are needed for mediation analysis? And if there are foundation or data or slash book, you would recommend to learn this technique?
Yes, so there is a book of, if you check this name, yeah, you will see a recent book of this author. And you can read this. This is one story. Another story, we will have a keynote presentations of a person from this group as well tomorrow. And I recommend to attend and continue a discussion after this presentation. How many waves? We need to try. We need to try. So I used Medicare data during 17 years for this analysis. Maybe it's applicable for HRS data is available.
Hi. I'm an epidemiologist, so I like come at the causal question from a different perspective. And so, you know, with these causal mediate, with any regression analyses, there's no confounding assumptions.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that you kind of taking care of all the confounders. And with causal mediation, there's even stronger, you know, no confounding assumptions, thinking about the exposure outcome relationship, but also the mediator outcome relationship. And so I think, you know, logistically, that can be hard to think about. Do I really feel like I have all the important confounders? But conceptually, especially with kind of race and SES disparities, even thinking about what are the confounders? Like, what are the things that I think have this causal upstream relationship that we need to be adjusting for? And this is something I think about a lot. And so I don't know how you approach that with the model building for the mediation analyses.
So you speak about this specific mediation analysis. Thank you. Look, there are several formulations, you know this.
Yeah.
I use the simplest approach that assumes a rare outcome. So there are exceptions of this approach that try to model baseline hazards somehow, splines or something like this. There are recent papers. All this, of course, I would recommend this extension, but we didn't use it. And yet, also, what we didn't use is all we didn't forget. This is the individual effect of the disease, but we plan to consider all the different together in the model and estimate the collective mediation effect. That's like this. Thank you.